In this series, we're going to take the Lexus GX for a ride just like this. The second generation body on frame, 2010 was the last time we saw a refresh. We don't receive the twin turbo like the Sequoia, we still house a V8 with rivals like a Land Rover Discovery, Defender, and a Volvo XC90. I'm Anthony from Hawkeye Rides. I'm gonna go over all the specs and details starting now. Lexus GX 460 has a dominant stance because it's gonna be wider than a Defender. It's gonna be taller, but the ground clearance is going to be better in the Discovery and the Defender, and also in the Volvo XC90. Triple beam LED headlamps, daytime running lights, LED fog lamps, 3 total skid plates, a curb weight at 5,266 pounds, with upgraded 19-inch dark gray metallic alloy wheels. The disc reading behind it at 13.3 inches, the rear at 12.3 inches, with a 3.9 axle ratio electronic transfer case, full-time four-wheel drive with a double wishbone front suspension and coil springs, multi-link rear suspension with air springs and auto leveling, both with an anti-roll bar. A length at 192.1 inches, a wheelbase at 109.8 inches. This is longer than the Defender 110 and the Disco, also longer than the Volvo XC90. What do you get with that? Towing will not be the best. 6,500 pounds is what we get here. It's gonna be better than the Volvo XC90. The only model we can option with a body on frame, more rugged performance is what you're going to be getting with that. On the lower part of the bumper, you get the plastic so you won't scratch it. Only one exhaust outlet, which because this is a V8, kind of wish they would have stressed more of that performance, because you know it's not gonna be a V8. Pretty soon they're going to go to the twin turbo and we're going to lose some of the performance, but it will increase horsepower and torque. Going into your cargo, it is a swing door going inside to 11.6 cubic feet. Behind the third row, you will have a 120 watt charger in the back. You can split fold these electronically in the rear at a 50-50 split, increasing cargo to 46.7 cubic feet. Fold down the captain chairs, increasing cargo to 64.7 cubic feet, which is more than the Volvo. We still have a V8 underneath this. Let's go inside, start it up so you can hear that exhaust note. Comes down to, in simple English, this is faster than the Land Rover variant. It's going to be slower than the Volvo variant, but you can get different options of engines, so it could be faster depending on the tier and how much money you want to spend. Here we only have one engine option. Let me know in the comments what you think about the 2023 Lexus GX 460 as we go inside, go over the tech, and take this for our drive. Entering inside the Lexus GX 460, running boards make it easy, the grab handle, 38 inches of headroom, 41.7 inches of legroom. This is gonna be more than the Defender in legroom, also more than the Volvo XC90. Semi-aniline leather wrap seats. 10-way power adjustment for the front occupants with heated and cooled seats. 10.3 inch with navigation. We got the pinch, we have the swipe. This was new for last year. 4G network, Mark Levingston 17 speaker premium sound system, Apple CarPlay, Android Auto, Sirius XM, AM, FM, streaming Bluetooth audio. Put it to reverse. We have a 360 degree reverse camera with trajectory. You can change the layout to make it a little bit more widescreen or a little bit more smaller. Working underneath with your air vents, dual climate control settings, a CD player, open up in here, and you're gonna have a storage pocket with 2 USB ports and a 12 volt. You'll have your touchpad that you can go through anything for your navigation. You can click into the menu so you can see every single app we have. More of the wood trim to open up to your cup holders that you could probably fit easy at 20 ounce. It's gonna be more sporty, but still pretty soft. This adjusts forward and backwards. You can't lift them that way. There's another one here that you click, opens it up, and you have a storage pocket on the top. It's a deep storage, it's pretty wide, and you got a little change holder here, and you can put a smaller cell phone. Leather wrap steering wheel and the wood 3-spoke multi-function. The gauge cluster will have a 4.2 inch full color readout in the center, otherwise it's going to be analog. The dashboard is going to be more simple, laid out, and you'll have your grab handles right here. The door panel gets a satin aluminum with the wood interior, soft for your elbows, memory for the driver, one touch up and down for your windows. It's a long storage pocket. It just narrows down into the back. For the second row, I'm at 40.4 inches of headroom, 35.2 inches of legroom, more than the Volvo XC90 here. These are captain seats. You can adjust these cup holders here, and you can slide these forward so I would have the most space in the third row. If I put it in the middle, it's kind of a happy medium for both of us. If I put it all the way back and recline this, I can't even really fit back there, which makes it a little bit more tight and undesirable. Your third climate control, heated rear seats, two USB-C ports, storage behind both of the front seats, air vents in the ceiling, and the door panel gets the everyday materials with the wood. You get the satin aluminum, soft for your elbows, one touch up and down. In the storage pocket, you could probably fit about two bottles. For the third row, I'm at 35.2 inches of headroom, 29.3 inches of legroom. Headroom is going to be more than the Volvo XC90, and you're pretty much on all of the rails, whether you're on either side of the seats because of these captain seats. It's going to be more firm material. You can recline these seats back, but that's pretty much the furthest you could go. You can recline it forward so you sit upright, and then headroom will be a little bit of an issue. 301 horsepower. This is what you get on some off-road-ish capabilities. And it's gonna just drive very smoothly. Visibility's good because you have over 8 inches of clearance. You have the power, 6-speed automatic transmission. Here, I wish they would have done an 8-speed. It would have been a little bit better with your gas consumption. I'm kind of glad we don't have the twin turbo to start off with, only because we could really see how it is with the Toyota Sequoia. 329 pound-feet of torque, an everyday drive. You're going to be hitting about 2.5 RPMs pretty much everywhere though, because of that 6-speed automatic transmission. It stays pretty planted for the most part. The seat settings, I kind of wish they had a little bit more braking. You're gonna have dual piston in the front, so that does help a little bit with your braking capacity. And the front windscreen is actually going to be the most sleek when you're looking at a Land Rover. Even the Volvo XC90 is gonna be a little bit longer, so this one's gonna be a little bit more sport derived. As for blind spots, this has huge windows everywhere. Livens up. It stays smooth in the interior. Gonna be a little bit more noisy than the Volvo XC90, and I would also say the Discovery. The Land Rover Defender will be about the same in the noise in the interior. The sound deadening could be a little bit better, but this is still off of a 2010 second generation. We're still waiting for a full refresh and obviously changing the engine. Now that's gonna take me to some things I like and dislike, and I'm gonna go over that right now. Starting off with what I like, this is still a body on frame. Everybody's going to a unibody. The nice thing about a body on frame is when you're towing, you don't feel it so much because it's a body and a frame. It's two separate components. Unibody is pretty much all configured together like a Lego, in which you're going to feel the towing a little bit more in the interior. As for the sound, that's why it's going to be a little bit more noisy because of the body on frame. Unibody will be a little bit more quiet. The second thing that I like about the vehicle, when you come to a stop and you can obviously configure it to turn it off, your cameras will turn on. So it's not just when you're reversing. I like this because this is nearly 200 inches. So it is a longer vehicle. Braking, you can do so without too many issues. Because it's a little wet, it might be a little bit more slippery. That's gonna also happen. This is an all-wheel drive, and it's all the time all-wheel drive. Turn radius at more or less a stop point is going to receive about, I'd say, 2 and a part lane. Let's rock and roll, baby. It just needed to find the right gear to just take off, and you could hear that engine roar. The last thing that I like about the vehicle is, for me, my dimensions. I actually fit perfect inside. It's not too overly wide. It's not too narrow for the armrest. It's pretty much where it's supposed to be. And I can still hold the steering wheel on the bottom. I don't have to hold it up here like this. And with Land Rovers, they give you that extra area here that you can hold. Kind of have that here too. Going into some things that I dislike, has to start off with the cargo. With the cargo cover, it's just way too much work, especially adding the power seat adjustment for the third row. Sometimes it takes longer than it would need to. I get the luxury perspective on it, but just make it a little bit quicker. Don't throw so much additives to cover up the cargo, because what also happens with that cargo cover, you lose some cargo because it's about 6 inches forward instead of backwards. So if you're trying to cover up things, you're still gonna see it in the second row. The second thing that I dislike is the center console. You have to go downwards to open it up fully. Otherwise, these top ones just slide this back and forth. Just make it a little bit easier for this center console. One button or one little strip that you push one, you push two, makes it a little bit easier design. The last thing that I dislike is the seat settings. You only get 10-way power seat adjustments. We're over $70,000. The Land Rover is going to have at least 12-way power adjustment. When you get into Volvo, they have 16 and 18-way with cushion extensions. You have the side bolstering to make it more sport-derived, massage seat capabilities. Kind of would like to see that in this price category. You will receive a larger infotainment screen in this comparing to the rivals, and that was updated for 2022 as well as this dashboard, but it's still off of a 2010 platform, the second gen. Does it need some refinements? Yeah, but the V8 engine I think is still fine. Maybe just tack on 8-speed automatic transmission so you get a little bit better gas consumption and you still have all your off-roading capabilities in your daily use. I'd like to thank Lexus of Wesley Chapel for giving us this 2023 Lexus GX 460 for our car review. If you're already a subscriber, thank you for being part of the Hawkeye community. If not, I don't know what you're waiting for. Click the next video and the subscribe button. Check out the merchandise, Instagram, and website, and everything we do here at Hawkeye Rides.